Welcome, everybody. So glad to have you on here today. My name is Jason DeBruyn. I'm the healthcare reporter for North Carolina Public Radio, WUNC. Hopefully some or many of you listen to 91.5 and have heard my voice. As you know, COVID-19 introduced many of us to the concept of public health and showed us the ways that health goes beyond the individual to impact whole communities and communities in different ways. Today, we have a unique opportunity to talk to two leaders who became the face of public health during an event that changed our lives and transformed the way we think about health. So joining us today is Dr. Mandy Cohen. She's the CEO of Allidade Care Solutions, but of course, before that, she was the director of the North Carolina Health and Human Services Department and was in many ways the face of our state's response to the COVID-19 pandemic. We're also joined by Dr. John Wiesman, who is a professor of practice in health policy and management at the Gillings School of Public Health, and also the director of the executive doctoral program in health leadership. Before that, he served under Governor Jay Inslee at Washington State. He was the secretary over there and the face of their pandemic response as well. So of course, we're excited to have them here today to talk about their experiences in managing a statewide public health response over the past few years. And of course, the lessons they learned from it and what we might learn from those lessons going forward. We'll spend about maybe 45 minutes or so with some conversation and maybe some questions by myself, but we do want to ask questions that you all have. And so if you do, you can write those in the chat box. We'll curate those and then get those to the panelists. So without further ado, we'll jump right in. Dr. Wiesman, I want to start with you since you were on the West Coast. Mm-hmm. We know certainly that the coronavirus sort of originated in Asia and then migrated this way. Clearly, I think everybody knew about it before we actually had our first case. But being as you were on the West Coast, talk about maybe were there any differences in how you were preparing or how early you started to prepare, maybe compared to what we were doing on the East Coast?
Well, thanks, Jason, for hosting us and UNC for having us. Mandy, it's great to be with you. I think awareness started being raised around the new year of 2020 as I started seeing sort of on the news, literally like the nightly news, reports of something going on in China with some kind of health issue. And of course, when we start seeing those things, our epidemiologists and others who are very connected to the Centers for Disease Control and other sort of professional organizations really start raising their awareness and looking for information of concern. So as we started seeing the cases rise, we were becoming very concerned even before our first case and starting to engage the healthcare system leaders, the hospital association, nursing, medical, and our governor's office and saying, hey, we need to be thinking forward here and thinking ahead to what might be coming down the road. And really started saying to folks, you need to start dusting off your pandemic flu response plans. And that was really even before we had our first case, just because of the concerning news coming out of China. And then, of course, on January 19th, I get a call while I'm at brunch saying, hey, we've got this 30-year-old male who showed up at a health clinic in one of our counties with fever and cough who had been in Wuhan. And while they don't meet the criteria really fully for being tested, CDC's agreed to test the sample anyway. And so on that Sunday, that sample was taken, flown to CDC. And on Monday afternoon, we learned that we had a positive case. And really, things started happening very quickly at that point, where then on Tuesday with CDC, we announced that. So that was sort of the very beginnings of the cases and from where I stood.
Dr. Cohen, I know in North Carolina, one of the things that you sort of told the media was that we don't have a confirmed case yet, but it's almost certain that there probably is a case in North Carolina that almost certainly was true before we had the first positive case. What was there a thinking or maybe even a hope early on that we were going to be able to isolate these cases and contain them and quarantine them and maybe not see the widespread pandemic that we ultimately did see?
Well, I think that was our hope at first, because we really didn't understand how infectious this virus was and how quickly it really spread around the globe. You know, in North Carolina, we were lucky in that we got the benefit of watching others see their first cases, react to it, put systems in place. Certainly, we watched what happened in Washington. Because it was nursing home focused, immediately we did different things in North Carolina to sort of prepare. But we did have some thoughts of cases that we thought maybe came through RDU in the January timeframe, turned out not to be the case, but it gave us a little bit of a chance to practice, if you will. So by the time we did have our first case, we really were trying to isolate. And we thought we could contain, but then it just quickly, we saw that that was not going to be realistic.
And since we weren't able to contain, obviously, North Carolina or really anywhere in the world, what sort of a playbook did either of you or both of you pull off the bookshelf, dust off, and say, hey, you know, I remember reading about this in one of my public health classes, or we learned about pandemics in other parts of the world, but this is real, this is us, this is happening for us. What were some of those early weeks? What were your strategies, and how well do you think those were executed?
Well, you know, we all had pandemic flu response plans, essentially. And those were plans that had been developed over time. And so we went to those initially. And, you know, honestly, as Mandy said, we all hoped initially we would be able to contain this. And, you know, it's basic public health doing that. It's identifying cases. It's finding out who they've been in contact with. You know, we know how to do that work. We do that work every single day in our lives. And so that piece, and especially in the beginning, was very familiar. And we were doing what we were trained to do. And we study incident command and how to request resources and how to work with partners and to get everybody on the same plan. So those pieces were in place and certainly helped facilitate in the beginning. The challenge is sort of Mandy said early on, we got overwhelmed with cases and how quickly they grew. And the plans sort of really were not as robust as they needed to be and didn't anticipate things like shortages of personal protective equipment and just the challenges of overwhelmed systems. Though many of us were warning our elected officials that the public health system was crumbling and, you know, needed an infusion of resources. So it wasn't a surprise.
I think in North Carolina, in some ways, we were lucky in that we had been through a lot of hurricanes. And that had really built a muscle in North Carolina about pulling various sectors together very quickly to respond. Obviously, no one thought when we did that it was going to be as long of a hurricane as it was with COVID. But you know, the first week of February 2020, the governor had already pulled together it was then called, you know, coronavirus task force, pulling together emergency management to education to our National Guard. Like, everyone was already around the table before we even had a case. And that muscle came out of our ability to react to hurricanes. Obviously, yes, we had a pandemic flu plan and we were doing that, but I at least felt like we were going to outstrip that. And we knew that pretty early on. I remember, and John, I don't know if you remember this, but I watched that viral video of when China built a hospital from the ground up in 10 days. And I remember watching it sitting at the governor's mansion for a cabinet meeting. I watched the video and I turned to the governor as like, we can't do that. I'm like, we're not going to be, oh my God. I don't, if that is that kind of a dramatic response that they are taking, this is different. And we have to mobilize now, because I know we're not going to build a hospital in 10 days. And so what are the things that we need to do to be ready? But it was a sort of a click moment for me. And I happened to be sitting next to my boss at the moment. And I do think it galvanized us quickly. And like I said, I think North Carolina was in a lucky place. We got to watch others see and get overwhelmed almost by this virus first, and we didn't. And that really helped us.
Yeah, I don't know the certificate of need laws in Washington state, but I don't know that the CON section would allow us to build a hospital in quite that quickly. And of course the PPE, right? I mean, as you said, John, you know, we really were in a situation where we were actually competing with other states to get PPE. And I remember, I don't have the story off the top of my head, but I know, you know, we were paying in some cases exorbitant amounts for gloves. N95s those weren't even anywhere to be had. That was just sort of you had to go from being health secretaries to being, you know, really working for UPS and a logistics manager at that point.
Yeah, it was truly insane is all I can say. States were competing against each other, countries, you know, businesses competing, hospital systems competing, all for a limited product. And the sort of ingenuity and the imagination that people took to get this product was amazing. And then sometimes it would come and it would not be of high quality. You know, you just paid for something that actually was defective. And that this happened over and over between personal protective equipment like the masks and gloves to testing equipment, the stuff you need to actually test samples in. It just kept repeating itself. And I hope that's one of the lessons we learned from this, is that we have to have much more robust systems of manufacturing, stockpiling, and really being ready to turn on a dime when we need this.
So I am curious. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me ask you about those lessons learned. I mean, because, you know, on the one hand, that sounds great to say, right? We need to have all these N95 masks and all this protective equipment and everything. But of course, that all costs money, and you have to store it somewhere, and it has a shelf life, and then you have to pay more money to restock it again. So at what lessons have you learned, Dr. Cohen, about like where, how much is the right amount? Should you maybe be able to, you get the question, go ahead.
That's exactly the point I was going to bring up, Jason, which is we got some supplies from the national stockpile, but they were all defective. I remember us opening up boxes and things were just like shreds of things and like totally unusable because they were past their shelf life and no one had opened up those boxes since they were put in there. And I understand that we just had never seen this scale of a need before. Go back to the hurricane example, you were always able to sort of reach back to supplies, but 50 states weren't experiencing that hurricane. Maybe it was 2-3 states, and you can reach to 47 other partners who were doing okay at the moment. And so you could always sort of make it work. But when we all needed the help all at the same time, that was the issue. And what I would say is we recognized that very early on in North Carolina, as I said, because we were later in things. We knew that supplies were going to go to Washington, supplies were going to New York, supplies were going to California. They were not coming to North Carolina. And so we quickly knew that we had to solve our own problem, that we would have to create it. And so we went, I think this is where private-public partnership was really critical. We went to some of our manufacturing plants right here in North Carolina. We're a manufacturing state, which is fantastic. So we went to some of those leaders. I would say NC State has an incredible material science lab, hugely important in helping us, not just for North Carolina, but for the country, in thinking about how can we mass produce some of these things. So I think we more quickly moved to that. And what I would say from a lessons learned is how do you solidify those partnerships so you can kind of keep them warm and turn them on, right? Because I think putting everything in like one big warehouse is like not going to be the cake. What we need are mechanisms that stay warm and that we can ramp up, and that there are mechanisms and accountabilities to say, look, we're going to give you some money to stay warm. And so that we can flip the switch. We, the federal government, or we, the state, or whomever is going to be able to get that supply and distribute in an equitable way.
I would agree. That's exactly right. And now that we know these things, we know like what we have to do and what has to be kept warm. And I think the issue with stockpiles, you do need a certain amount on hand, but we can also do that through vendor managed inventories where, you know, you don't just stockpile them and then wait for them to expire, but you have product that you actually rotate through, you know, where you know it's going to get used and you replenish it. So that you're not in the case, don't find yourself as we did where you have unusable product.
Yeah, and I even remember like local breweries local companies that make liquor, you know, switch production to making hand sanitizer and things of that nature. So it's really sort of a, but to your point, I mean, it would make sense, as opposed to having a bunch of hand sanitizer on a shelf somewhere, have a relationship with these local manufacturers who you can say, hey, we need you to stop what you've been doing. We love it. What you've been doing is great. But right now we're have this really important thing and we need you to switch to this. We'll pay you for it. But yeah, that does seem to make a lot more sense.
Right. And know that we've solved for an airborne illness. I do think that we need to do some scenario planning on different kinds of transmissibility and, you know, and making sure that we're thinking that through, because it's always the thing you didn't think of that you wish you would have. But I think there's some core lessons here, but I do think we need some additional scenario planning thought here.
As a member of the media, one thing that I appreciated was that there were these regular press conferences, and that mostly, Dr. Cohen, I'll speak for you specifically, but it seems across the country, mostly health secretaries were open about, here's what we know, here's what we want to find out, but here is what we don't know. And you know, we're trying to learn, but we're all in this together. Maybe talk a little bit about the strategy of being so open. I think you said you held a total of 175 press conferences, which is incredible. I was on a lot of those. I can remember them. but maybe talk about that strategy of just, even if we don't know something, we want to tell people that we're not quite sure, but we're going to figure it out. Talk about that strategy and maybe how you think that worked.
Sure. Well, you know, I've thought about crisis communications at other points in my career, and you know, crisis communicators would tell you, get all the facts before you communicate. That's not reality in an evolving pandemic. So, okay, what's the second best choice, which is communicate often and be clear. And I think the times where the communication didn't go as well from various parties was when they presented things with more certainty than I think we could at the moment at different points, because it was the change that was so hard for folks. And particularly if we can anticipate a problem, but we weren't there yet, we can kind of soften the ground or lay the groundwork to say, like, here's what we're seeing now, we're not there yet, but here's what we're gonna need to do. I also thought at the beginning, there was so much we didn't know that we had to do more dramatic things as we learned and as we were able to gather more information. So we had to be more dramatic in the actions we took so that it bought us some time to just learn. And I wanted folks to understand that, to be like, we are in a gathering phase. Look at all the things we don't know here. We don't have N95s for our nurses right now. We can't have any cases of COVID at our hospital because I can't protect people, which is a different threshold than once we had protective equipment and we had testing and we could identify and right, that then we can tolerate more. And trying to explain that I thought was really hard at the beginning, but we just tried to over and over explain what we were looking at, why, and what we didn't know.
Yeah, and never mind that you're first having to explain it to people who, you know, do not have medical degrees, and then expecting us to translate that into and disseminate that to folks. I can understand how that's difficult. John, what was y'all's?
I thought the press was a really important component of our response effort. And most people don't have medical degrees nor public health degrees. And so it was right that how we were talking about this should be to help folks who don't know this world, help them understand it. So I think that was absolutely the right space and why we spent so much time with the press corps in North Carolina.
Well, let's spin it forward a little bit. You know, after that initial wave, right, things did die down a little bit. I think we all sort of learned how to live with COVID for a little bit. I'm talking, you know, summer, fall of 2020, before the vaccine was available. You know, people did ultimately get masks. The protective equipment was there. That initial wave died down. To the extent you can remember back to that part, Dr. Wiesman, you know, where did your focus turn at that point when you had maybe a moment to breathe, even with a mask on, but if you had a moment to breathe and think about, okay, what's the next step towards getting to the vaccine?
Right. So, I mean, at that point, part of it too was helping various business sectors understand how to, as safely as they can, operate. Like what guidelines they were looking for guidance, whether it was wedding planners or bowling alleys or sports clubs, right? So there was this piece of trying to help give them guidance on how they could more safely go about their businesses. And of course, as a regulatory agency, we were still figuring out like, what were we going to allow or not allow? And then as we started thinking towards vaccine, it really became planning for that. And the challenge here was you were planning with variables you didn't exactly know. So you didn't know exactly at the point, how were these going to be distributed? Was that going to be something that happened through the federal government, states? What were the vaccines actually going to be? What kind of time frame to actually, you know, be vaccinated and get a second dose if there was one? So the planning variables were just really challenging because you didn't know exactly what you were planning for. But all that said, I think one of the successes out of this that we all have to acknowledge was how quickly the vaccines were developed. And thankfully, that was the case. And the federal government, you know, made some really wise decision making to move forward with trying, you know, supporting different vaccines, purchasing them in advance, even if they weren't sure it was going to work. Because part of all of our work was, how do you try and keep people as safe as you can until vaccines are available, until the personal protective equipment were available, as Mandy said, you know, until the therapeutics were available and are available to actually, you know, try and prevent hospitalization if you get sick. So I will admit, as a leader, things were incredibly overwhelming. And, you know, my ability to sometimes rise way above this, to be able to see out as far as I should have, was a bit limited, just by the overwhelming nature of the day to day. And certainly as a leader, that's one of the lessons I learned, is how to rise up above that as much as one can.
It occurs to me that so much of this response is, you know, in communication. You know, you talk about communicating to regular folks, you talk about communicating to businesses. I wonder if maybe that's one of the lessons learned as well, that, you know, you have this whole, the first, you know, the first level response to the actual pandemic, but then actually being able to communicate that effectively to, in North Carolina's case, 10 million people nationwide, 300 and whatever we are, 50 million people. Maybe talk about any lessons you learned in communication and how those might be used going forward in a pandemic, or just, you know, in regular responses to the things that health secretaries face every day.
Well, I can start. We certainly spend a lot of time thinking about communications, that it needed to be simple, it needed to be memorable, and it needed to be specific. And so Jason knows our three W's campaign, and that, you know, that I said the three W's more than I could ever imagine in a lifetime, right? We had to say it a million times, say something simple, but that's what we needed people to do. Three actions. And those are really it until we had vaccines or therapeutics. It was like, do three things. I was really proud of our team for, you know, we did the market research to come up with that work really quickly, deploy it and get it into everyone's hands. And then I appreciate businesses articulating that and everyone kind of getting on board. So everyone was hearing the same message over and over. And I know that when I would get stopped at Target and say, are you the three W's lady, that it was working. So, you know, principles of like clear, simple, repeatable, but and then you know, the partners to blast it. I think the other part is about trusted messengers. Sometimes I was the right messenger for some folks, but oftentimes not. And so who are the trusted messengers? We, and Jason knows as well, we did a ton of work on getting and lifting up voices from every community in every language to make sure that religious leaders were involved, that business leaders were involved, teachers were involved, you know, bus drivers were involved. Everyone had a voice in this and wanted to lift that up because we needed the trusted voices across this. So it's both the message, the repetition, and the trusted messenger.
I really agree with that. The thing I would add to that as well is communicating in other languages than English. And, you know, thinking about how people get their information through what sources, and really working through those trusted, you know, partners to get that information out. So if we think about the diversity, equity, and inclusion, again, even right from the beginning in terms of communication, who really had equitable access to that was a challenge. And I think we've learned a lot. And those are systems we need to keep maintaining, right? We can't turn those off. We should be using those now every single day.
Then vaccines did come out, as you say. You know, Operation Warp Speed really did work quite effectively. And one thing, Dr. Cohen, that I've always given you credit for is that you emphasized equity and trying to get the vaccine into all 100 counties, and emphasized equity even if it meant at the cost of speed in some cases. But trying to get the vaccine to as many different people as possible. Maybe talk a little bit about some of the lessons you learned early on in vaccine distribution, where it was. I mean, it almost felt like you needed a Brinks truck for you know, transporting these doses, because so many people, you know, wanted them. Talk about that experience and maybe what you learned in terms of trying to get such a scarce resource into vulnerable people.
I think this is a space where I want to make sure there are a lot of lessons retained, because I had never experienced the profound scarcity of resource. Now, every day there are members of our communities that are experiencing scarcity of those resources, but the profound nature of everyone and the scarcity of this was something that, you know, as John said, like, did I have the visibility to actually anticipate it? I didn't. I didn't even have the mental model for it. And I think we went in with one mental model and quickly meshed with reality and had a very different mental model within weeks. And I think the fact that we were able to pivot quickly helped us in North Carolina, but we retained certain principles. And one that you mentioned was the equity principle, to say, like, that is bedrock. No matter how we pivot in terms of improving speed, equity is still going to be the bedrock of what we do, but we can't do equity without visibility on what is happening. I need to know where every dose is. I need to know what arm it's going into, in which communities, so that we can make those decisions. And it goes back to a tough decision that North Carolina made, which was to actually create our own vaccine registry and database. We did not use the federal government one. John, I'm curious how you made that decision. Mm-hmm. But for us, you know, our choices were use our legacy system, use the federal government's, or build our own. And it's a big risk to build your own. We had never used it before, right? Now we're adding a new element of risk into all of it, but it was so important. It was probably the most important decision I made in the whole vaccine effort, because it allowed us the visibility and the control to maintain equity in our work, and still allowing for speed. So we knew where the vaccines were they sitting, how could we move them, and we could dictate to our vaccine partners to say, if you can't get this into an arm in 7 days in this equitable way, it's coming back to us and we're gonna give it to someone who can execute on that. And that was very hard to do, but we couldn't have done any of that without foundationally understanding where our vaccines were, who was delivering them, to whom, in what time, for all those things. And so I just want to make a plug for the team's excellent work in getting that done. And then, you know, making sure that we really had to partner with folks who had scale. This is where I think we have to really remember lessons learned in North Carolina. Like, we have a, you know, very good public health system, but it's very decentralized. And when you want to make a huge response effort, scale is really important. And this is where our health systems really played a really important role for us in getting to scale. And that was a really important part. John, I'm really curious on how things went for you in Washington.
Yeah, so I transitioned right about that time in January, right as the vaccine was rolling out. I think we used a combination of our immunization information system with some add-on products to do that, but also really reached out to the private sector to help with this in terms of even setting up the systems and managing them, and people who had much more sort of experience with how you do real-time, tracking of product. And being in the tech, sort of one of the tech states, we were able to tap into the Amazons and the Microsofts and their resources to do that. So that was the importance, as you were saying earlier, of the public-private partnerships that really came to bear. I think, you know, one of the pieces with the vaccine prioritization, we wanted to work so hard on equity that we often got the sort of prioritization very complex. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think we have to go back and look at to maintain equity, how do we do that in a more simple way? I was sort of impressed with some of the European countries on how they started by age group, you know, and knowing that they were at high risk. But I think we've got to look through that because it became very complicated for the public. Well, am I eligible or not? And then you had people who were trying to cut lines. And so this piece of equity and how we stay true to that and also have something that's simple and workable is, I think, some things we have to go back and look at.
I wonder if I could double back to something that both of y'all said. You indicated that you learned how to rise up and sort of be able to long range plan and try to see the whole picture to the extent possible. I wonder if you could expand on some of what you learned and how you might teach others to do the same.
Well, one of the lessons I'm sharing in my role here, and it's a very sort of honest personal lesson, is I lost myself in the pandemic response. And by that, I mean every waking moment of my day and actually nights were focused on COVID. I would wake up at literally, and I don't, Mandy, if this is true for you, there were days when the numbers were increasing and we couldn't get our data systems to get data out, that I would literally wake up at 2 a.m. in a cold sweat. Just panicked and not able to go back to sleep. Just, you know, totally worried about how are we going to make this work today? And I would get up and I would start working on email and doing work. And I would find colleagues of mine from the West Coast also on the computer at the same time, doing the same thing. So the lesson I've learned for me as a leader is I have got to somehow keep certain routines in my life. And even in a pandemic or a hurricane response or whatever it is, I have to take care of me first in order to be able to do my job in leading. And you know, it took me sort of failing at that at one point and actually seeking help from my healthcare provider to sort of retune what I needed to do. So that's one thing I would encourage is like, we have to teach people how to take care of ourselves during these times. And we're always told that. And I found sort of my place where, oh, I really did reach my breaking point, you know, like I have a breaking point too. and being human about that, I think, is incredibly important. Then I think from there, it is just making sure I help create the right role and space for me and others to do that forward-thinking planning. And that means you have to staff and resource that. The challenge, of course, was staff and resources were hard to come by. People were just trying to handle the day-to-day. But it's important to carve out a piece for that. And I don't know, Mandy, maybe you were more successful at that than I.
Well, I will say leading through this was the most intense thing I've ever done. And folks who've known me my whole career know that I really love to work. I work hard. But this did send me close to the edge of what that breaking point. And it was incredibly hard. And it wasn't even just the hours, which were intense, but it was the weight of these hard decisions that, you know, we recognize, and we're asking a business to close. It's just, I sometimes still wake up and agonize over these hard decisions. Nothing was easy. You know, the things that I thought were really important to focus on was about trust. And it always came back to trust for me in leading through a crisis, that what are the ways in which you can cultivate trust amongst your team, amongst the the broader folks that you are leading. And for me, it came down to really two things. One was transparency, which is actually really hard in a crisis because things are not going well. It's a crisis by definition, right? When a hurricane hits, like only bad things are happening. And so being transparent about all the things that are hard, it is a challenge, but necessary, right? We have to put the numbers up to say, you know what, we are seeing a lot more cases in our African-American community. And like, we need to do something about that. But in order to like have the data and be transparent about it, it means you are sharing places in which you are not doing well. And that is hard to do. The other is on the topic we talked about, which is the proactive communication. And often we talked about the talking, right? Everyone notices that in like the governor at a podium. But really what you didn't see was so much listening. There's a ton of listening to stakeholder feedback, to from the business community, to religious, to African American community leaders, to our General Assembly, to our press corps, who was often reflecting what they were hearing from others. You know, that's a lot of listening and trying to take that in and synthesizing that, that I think was really important to building trust. So those are some core just leadership lessons about how do you lead in a transparent way. And how do you proactively communicate, recognizing that's both your personal articulation, but also the listening posture.
So then we did get more vaccines shipped to us, you know, across the country, and you know, a larger swath of the population were able to get vaccines. Then at that point, were you maybe able to get a full night's rest? I suspect you were still waking up in cold sweats at times, or even having dreams about all this. Was there a little bit less stress, hopefully, at that point?
I think there was a moment in, I want to say, May or June, right? So John was off now in academia and enjoying life, I hope,
yes.
Here in North Carolina. But it was a sprint through April and really into the beginning of May, just getting everyone vaccinated. And there was like this moment, this magic moment before Delta. where we were like, we did it, everyone's getting vaccinated, it's happening. And it was spring and flowers are bloom. And it was like three awesome weeks. and then, you know, as everything in this pandemic, but this is where I mean, where I think we were a little too definitive with some spiking of the football, where this virus then evaded, you know, changed, got more contagious, started to evade our vaccine. And, you know, the humility that I learned in those moments to be like, we're not done yet, was really important. And I think that's another just takeaway from an evolving pandemic and watching science play out in front of us, is that we weren't quite done, but we had those magic few weeks in June. It was amazing.
Well, and I wonder now that you're both no longer in those chairs, and perhaps I won't say free to be more critical, but maybe free to give some broader thoughts. In some ways, are we in that same position right now? It's more than 3 weeks, right? More people are vaccinated. There isn't a spike yet in the whatever the new variant might be. So people are feeling better, but are I don't think anybody's spiking the football. So I think we've learned that.
Yes.
Or are they starting to maybe get a little bit too cocky, or are we doing better than we did basically exactly a year ago?
Well, I'll quickly start. I'm curious what John thinks. You know, we kept getting better as well, right? We sort of worked through the vaccine, but we didn't have the availability of rapid tests in a way that I would have liked. We certainly didn't have the therapeutics, the treatments, certainly ones that were we only had infusion treatments, which inherently is a challenge. And we only just had pill treatments in the last couple months, even. So we keep putting pieces in place that allow us to say, we are getting better at handling this. So at each stage, we can say, okay, well, now we have vaccines. Now we have more available rapid tests. Now we have more therapeutics. We have great supply chain for PPE. We're getting there, and each time you can sort of take a more of a deep breath out. But I think we still have to remember it is with us. So we can't leave it behind. You have to use all the tools. You have to make sure you're getting your boosters, have to make sure you're still doing rapid tests when you have some symptoms so that you don't expose those who are immunocompromised and are still pretty vulnerable. So I think those are going to become, as long as those stay part of our day-to-day, like keeping up with those things, then I think that we will live with this virus. But we have to actually use the tools. We can't go back. We're not going back to 2019. I think we have to be in a posture of saying like, it's with us, but it means we have to use the tools. So if you get COVID, you know, and you have underlying medical conditions, you should be calling your doctor about Paxlovid and seeing if that's right for you.
I fully agree with Mandy. I think that's exactly right. It's the path we're on. We have to stay with that path. And if we stay with that path, there isn't a need to sort of go back to the, you know, close everything down. That was a strategy for waiting for these other things to happen, the vaccines, the therapeutics. So that's exactly right. I think what I do worry a little bit about is that, you know, these tools and masks being like the lightning rod piece, right? I think we have to be prepared that there are times that as cases rise that, you know, folks should really mask up. And there might even be times where people feel the need to actually like order that. You know, depending on what happens in communities and what the spread is, I'd really like to see us sort of be much more comfortable with that as individuals. And, you know, frankly, making our personal choices about, hey, you know, like, there are times I walk through the hallways here at UNC without a mask on. But if I'm going into a classroom with a lot of folks, I mask up, you know, at this point, because I want to protect others who may have health conditions I don't know about, as well as protect myself. And I think the mask issue has sort of for the public, and this is a communication issue, Mandy, I think that we all could have done a bit better on, is when we say masks are no longer required, everybody feels like, oh, the pandemic's over. No, it's exactly what Mandy talked about. These are tools we have in our toolkit that we need to keep using at the right times. And it doesn't signal that the pandemic is over. And I think we have not done a great job communicating for the public these transitions. In part, they've happened pretty quickly at times. And we haven't said to people what this means and like what we think is going to happen when we go here. And really prepare them. And that, to me, is a communication issue.
You mentioned masks, and being a news reporter, I feel compelled to ask at least one topical question, and that is obviously, you know, masks are in the news this whole week. I wonder what y'all think about the judge's ruling and masks no longer being required on public transportation or a lot of public transportations, airlines specifically. Curious your thoughts on that little bit of news this week.
Well, I think there are two issues. I'm curious where John is on it. One is, does the CDC have authority to say masks should be required at certain times? And then the issue is like, do we still need to invoke that authority at this moment? So on the authority question, I absolutely think they have the authority, and thus I think they need to appeal. That was not the right decision. They have the authority. I think it's right to ask the ongoing question, as we always should. Do we need to use that authority at this moment? And I think that's an evolving question. I think that thing, you know, things were going down. The issue with transportation in particular, as you know, is people use it to get to their jobs, and they don't have a choice, right? It's different than if I buy a ticket to the Hurricanes game. I'm making a choice. I'm assessing my own risk. All those things. But if I don't have a choice, I have to get to my job. I don't have a choice. And I think we have to understand that there are going to be certain scenarios where their choice is not there for folks. And then what do we want to do to make sure that everyone can be safe? And what are the things where you're making a choice, and we now have enough tools in our toolbox to assure that your choice is not going to overrun our health systems. So I think we are in a different moment, but I absolutely think like CDC has the authority, got to appeal that rule. A question mark on like, how long do we use that authority going forward? John, curious where you are on
it. Yeah, I think I'm at the same place, and we're at this sort of question mark of transition. When is that time to sort of remove the mandate part while still encouraging people who want and, you know, to wear a mask in transportation. I think an issue with transportation too, especially depending on the kind, is you get a lot of mixing from different parts on planes, for example. So this is not any longer just like your local community transmission. People are coming from a lot of different places, and what are the transmission rates in other places? So I think transportation is a bit trickier about that, and probably should be one of the last places that we sort of remove a mandate for that. I can tell you, I traveled last weekend and I was happy to wear my mask. And if I were traveling today, I would wear a mask, and I take public transit to work and I wear a mask. It just seems to make a lot of sense, and I can make that choice.
Yeah, I'll actually give a plug to Go Triangle here in the area, where the bus driver, I was actually on a bus where one person sort of had the chin strap mask situation going on, and the driver made him put his mask on, and which I definitely appreciate it. So for anybody out there that takes Go Triangle, I always support getting on the bus if you can. We got this interesting question from somebody in the audience. How did you manage misinformation while also being transparent about not knowing all the answers, especially in the earlier parts of the pandemic? Go ahead, Dr. Cohen.
So for us on misinformation, it was fundamentally about building trust foundationally, right? So that folks could distinguish between where can I trust getting reputable information and not. So it was fundamentally the trust focus that we did was our strategy to combat misinformation. The other was the flood the zone, like flood everyone with good information. Right. I didn't have a lot of tools to pick off and say, like, please don't publish this thing. My tool was, can we overwhelm that with good information? So those are really our two tools. I think the federal government has more tools at its disposal that it could be using in terms of regulating entities and allowing the Twitters, Facebooks of the world to propagate some of the misinformation the way their algorithms work. I do think that needs to be at least looked at. But at least from the North Carolina perspective, right? Trust and repetition.
Same in Washington, and it goes back to another point Mandy made, is who's the trusted messenger as well, right? So making sure that the trusted messengers are the ones delivering the message. And sometimes that was us and sometimes it wasn't.
I think it's also really important to understand, like, where that misinformation is coming from. It is coming from a place of fear and folks wanting to, like, have answers. And I, like, totally understand that. And so it's really important not to just if you see something, like, not disregard, but kind of get under it a bit. Like, is it coming from a particular community with where, why is that happening? They're searching around for answers that are going to keep them safe. And so the question is, like, how can I better, as a leader, connect with that community about how to best keep them safe? So that's most of the time what was my reaction when I would see something of misinformation. And kind of, let's get underneath that a little bit more and try to get at it.
I don't think we have time to get into this, but Dr. Cohen, you sort of gave me a little in where you were talking about how you maybe think Twitter or Facebook or other platforms should be more tightly regulated as to what they say. That's obviously not the topic for this discussion, I guess, but I would be hearing more of your thoughts. Would like to hear more of your thoughts on that at some point.
I'm happy to do one more sentence on it, I think folks should be able to say what they want to say. This is not about that, but should they be able to say it through a major megaphone? I don't know. I think that's the place where and that's where these promotion algorithms, where we make something you may have said to you and your friends become something that then gets put out in the world in a megaphone way. Like, that's the place where I'm like, that feels like a privilege, not a right, to have the megaphone part. And so what are the right ways in which we need to think about that? Again, I want folks to be able to say what they want to say, feel how they want to feel. and I want my job as a leader to say, help me understand that. And like, can we find a place of some common understanding? And maybe we won't, but I'm happy for them to say the things. It's the question of like, then did they get to be promoted a million times? I don't know.
No, that's fair. That's fair.
And then it's the organized efforts actually to intentionally do this, which also I think needs to be looked at. That's not just sort of an individual's sharing their free speech.
Let's maybe take a big picture look. With everything that you've learned over the past couple of years, and perhaps even before that, what advice do you have for current or future public health officials, maybe even particularly at the state or even local level, where it really is sort of that first level of response, for how that they might, I don't even want to say approach another pandemic, because you know we're probably going to face some other major crisis before we face another COVID-like pandemic, right? So what are the big picture lessons learned from the COVID-19 response that could apply to, you know, whatever it is that comes next? John, go ahead. We'll start with you this time.
Oh, no. Well, first of all, I would say, first of all, thank you, everybody who has been doing the work on the front lines. This is really hard work to do. I know it's been hard for everyone. It's been hard for everybody to live through this. And lots of people have lost people they've cared about through this, which, you know, we need to acknowledge this impact as well. I think, you know, there are many lessons learned. I think putting front and center, as Mandy has, the pieces of trust, of keeping equity centered in everything we do, and that we are engaging the folks who we are serving at every place that we can, is incredibly important. And when we do that, we will make better decisions. We will know the issues that we really need to respond to. That's critical. I think, you know, there are 1,000 lessons learned. I think my hope is that, Mandy, how did you say it? Lessons, not lessons learned, but lessons remembered, lessons implemented. What you had a great phrase earlier.
Oh, I've already forgotten it.
Yeah.
But it's being transcribed, so we'll pick it up later.
All right. But I think, you know, we seem to need to constantly relearn some lessons. Like, we fund a crisis at the time, we throw tons of money at it, and then we move on to another crisis and sort of defund whatever we were doing. And that's part of what the problem was with COVID, is bioterrorism came, lots of money was thrown at various systems. We developed systems, we had isolation and quarantine facilities, we had more epidemiologists. That money went away. And when we needed those things again, they weren't there. So I hope we learn the lesson of really implementing our lessons learned, retaining them, and supporting the people who are doing the work.
I wonder what reflections you got. Oh, go ahead, Dr. Cohen.
Yeah, Mandy.
No, let me share a couple of things. Just one very tactical thing that I think folks need to be focused on right now, which is underlying data infrastructure. Yeah. You can't make good decisions that John was talking about without good data, and you need surveillance systems, you need the right data transfer, you need the pipes to be there to transfer data in a secure way. So data infrastructure feels like really, really critical for our ability, whether it's a bioterrorism or another pandemic or a hurricane, right? I think it is such an important component for good decision-making. So I just say tactically, I'm very, very proud of like the kinds of work we did in North Carolina on the data infrastructure side. I want to see that across states, and that the recovery dollars, when we think about infrastructure, data infrastructure needs to be part of that. So that's just one very tactical one. And the other is less tactical, but should be turned into tactical, which is relationships. And again, I started with saying North Carolina was lucky because we had a muscle that was built in hurricane. We had relationships. Our health systems were really tied into emergency management, particularly the ones out east. That really helped. But what we didn't have and we built through the pandemic was deeper relationships to our historically marginalized communities. I think we made tons and tons of really wonderful connections there that I worry we're not in a crisis anymore. We kind of go back to business as usual, but you really need to maintain those relationships and that maintain that trust, because if the trust is high going into the crisis, so much better. I think we're learning more and more that the places that fared best in COVID response had societal cohesion. What a hard thing to actually measure. But for me, when I hear societal cohesion, that's trust. And relationships and connection. And I think we have to get better as leaders for tactically implementing societal cohesion or those connections or relationships. That's something I'm processing through, of like, how do we actually embed that into core work so we are prepared going forward?
Well, and building off that exact point, you know, one of the things that greatly would help, I think, is a better trust in public health, right? Maybe a better understanding and a better trust in public health. Do you think, certainly there's a better, I won't necessarily say understanding, but awareness, I'll say, of public health systems in the United States. Again, I won't say better understanding because I don't know that that's true, but I wonder if you have any thoughts about how people at the very top or people at important positions, high level positions, can improve communication to regular folks about public health and how this isn't just some topic that we get master's degrees in. I mean, it's something that actually impacts individuals and communities every day.
I'm going to let the academic on public health talk about this first, but I have some thoughts.
I think part of it goes to trust, as Mandy was talking about earlier, and building relationships. But I also think that this isn't something public health can do alone, right? We need our leaders standing up and uniting. We need the elected officials uniting. We need corporate America uniting. And that may be a tall order, but this isn't something we can do on our own. In some cases, some of those individuals have put us in that spot of difficulty. So I don't know that there's an easy answer, and I'm waiting to hear what Mandy's answer is.
Well, one of the things I think is important and I haven't seen done well yet is just articulating what we mean when we say public health, and articulating in a way to a voter to say, this is what we should invest in. Just as we would say, this is what I mean when we say, improving education. So I think that public health is much more than pandemic response. But we haven't articulated, what are you buying? What should you expect in every community in America from the public health system? I think there's not agreement on that in the public health world. I don't think that it has to be super, this is the box, but I do think we have to do a better job of just articulating what we want our public health system to do and then make that true, make that true in reality, because make that true in a standardized way across the United States. I think what people experience public health in North Carolina is different than what they experience from public health in Washington State. And it feels like there needs to be that baseline there. And I think that will help on the trust factor, Jason, that you were talking about, because they know what to expect and when it's going well and when it's not going well, and we need to course correct.
Not too much more time, and we do have a couple people who are sort of asking this real big picture, what happens next? So I guess I'm going to put this into two parts. Are we ready to move into the endemic phase of COVID-19, and what does that look like, both at a high level, if you're a DHHS secretary or a county level health leader, or if you're just an individual, like, what does that mean for me as COVID-19 enters an endemic stage? And then sort of the second part of that, which I think is on everybody's mind, is are we more prepared? Like, when something like this happens again, have we remembered these lessons? Have we internalized all these supposed lessons learned so that we don't make the same mistakes? I mean, hopefully the answer is yes, but I wonder what you all think.
All right, I'll go first this time.
Sorry.
So what is living with COVID look like right now? And I think I think we were talking in the mask conversation, we got into this. Everyone's like, if I'm wearing a mask, COVID's here. And if I'm not wearing a mask, COVID's not here. And that is not the right way to think about it. I think the right way to think about it is we are in this phase, whatever this phase, and there are going to be other phases in this phase of where we are with COVID. I think you want to be thinking about your personal risk, but also make sure that you're using all the tools. So yes, maybe you are not wearing a mask when you are, moving about your normal life, but if you wake up feeling not good in the morning, right, and you feel a little achy, fevery, stuffy nose, cough, take a COVID. You should have COVID tests at home, and you should be taking a COVID test. It's negative. Hey, it's allergies, it's North Carolina's got a lot of pollen right now, right? Or whatever, you have another virus that's circulating around. Take a test and then make sure that you're acting on that test. And if you do have COVID and you are at high risk, make sure you are getting medicine, contacting your doctor. There are things that we can do. So I think I wanna make sure everyone has rapid tests at home. They know how to use it. I will tell you, I have held up like little rapid tests on Zoom, and there's plenty of people who are like, what's that? That's not okay. We all have to get familiar with how to do a rapid test. We got it. You can get them free from the federal government. They're getting paid for by Medicare, right? So have rapid tests at home. So that's more what I want folks to get into of this phase of COVID. Also, how long has it been since your last booster? Are you eligible for another? Those kinds of things. And I'm sure folks are working on version 2.0 of a vaccine. When it's ready, get your vaccine, right? Though that's what this next phase will look like. And are we prepared? Yes, but everyone's tired right now. Like if we were to get another, new virus strain, everyone is tired. We are all so over it, right? And so I would worry about just our ability to sustain this level of intensity any further. We need a recovery period. We need to move on to other things. But we have to institutionalize some of these lessons learned we've been talking about. But we're going to be ready. Just like we got better at hurricane response in North Carolina, you don't ever want to get great at crisis response because that just means there's a lot of crises. But I think we are definitely better off than we were before.
And Mandy said many of the things I wrote down, in addition to the rapid tests, and I would say have the masks at home ready to go if you're not using them now, hand sanitizer, right? The good hygiene pieces are important. And as Mandy said, these are free from the federal government. Take advantage of these while they are available. And check when your test kits are expiring, right? Like put in a request for, more. That's what we all ought to be doing. I think too, just this, let's remember that when we're ill, we should stay home. Even if you have a cold, like I really don't want to go out to dinner with you if you have a cold. Is dinner that important? No. Why don't you just let me know and we can reschedule, right? So this isn't just about, this is all COVID. This is about just health in general for us. And I agree about we're more prepared, but there is a lot of work to do to be able to give the response that all of us would. Mandy hit on a critical one in terms of the data modernization work. We came a long way, but we are still far from where any of us, I think, want to be in this space. So we've got to do that. We've got to give our folks some time to re-energize a bit as well. They are exhausted, whether they're healthcare workers, public health workers, even folks who are in some of our service businesses. So what's incumbent upon us is that we do the analyses we need of all the lessons learned, prioritize them, and put them into action. And that in part means federal government needs to make sure that they are funding for the long term these projects, that they stick with us on these, that our memory doesn't become short and we move on to the next crisis, which there are many, out there. So if we do that, we'll be in a much better place. And I think one policy that we ought to have in this country, which is not novel, but it is really hard to get anybody to pass, is that we should have a unique health patient identifier for every single person that is connected to a demographic database that that healthcare providers and the right folks can have access to. Mandy, I was listening to you on another piece of something you did in the last month and talking about the importance, for example, of race ethnicity data. It is incredibly important and we have to have it at a more granular level. But there is no reason every healthcare provider should have to be asking you these questions. This should be in a database that I know how to contact you. I know your race ethnicity. I know the language you speak and prefer, you know, like that was such a barrier for a lot of our work in public health around case and contact investigations. You didn't have a contact info that came through. You had no idea what language people spoke. So if you left a message in English or call, like you couldn't be understood. We don't need to be at that place. And a policy of having a unique health identifier for every individual, just like our driver's license, just like our social security card, and linked to this database with a limited number of data elements that can really improve care for people would be like my dream.
Well, we'll end it there. Dr. Wiesman is the former DHHS secretary out in Washington State. Now he's at the Gilling School of Public Health. Dr. Cohen, of course, the DHHS secretary here in North Carolina, now at Adelaide Health. It's based in DC, but I think you still live here, right? You still live in North Carolina?
Still here. Adelaide is a national company. Plan to raise my husband and I plan to raise our girls here in North Carolina.
Very good. Very good. Well, and of course, I'm Jason DeBruyn with North Carolina Public Radio. Thank you so much for being here. It's really been a good conversation. Certainly, this won't be the last time we talk about COVID, I suppose, but hopefully we'll be able to take some of these lessons and apply them to the future. So thanks very much, and until we see you again.